All right. Well, that's already some introduction here. Glad to see you all here. And yeah, well, I wanted to tell you about when to use machine learning, when not to use it, from my personal experience. And first of all, I wanted to thank Jibes and Big Data Vilnius for enabling me to speak here today. Also, you can ask questions, so you can write them down during the presentation, and then I'll get to them at the end. You can go to this URL, fill in Big Data 2018, Jules Hall 5, and yeah, we can talk about them. So first, something about myself again. I studied methods and statistics at the Utrecht University in the Netherlands, which I find is a very useful study for actually machine learning afterwards. Then some titles. I'm an Intel AI innovator and a Kaggle master, which pretty much means that I did well in a couple of competitions. I'm a lead data scientist or lead consultant at Jibes Data Analytics, where there are currently 35 data scientists. And I've been working there for 4 years at about 15 plus different companies. And I've worked on blockchain for some time, natural language processing, machine learning, deep learning in general, and also social robotics. So you can see here an example where at a company you try to, yeah, to have a robot have interactions with people and see how that goes. Yeah, furthermore, I love open source and tech innovation in general. And I'm specifically fascinated by human and machine interaction, like how can machine learning, for example, help enable people with their work. So then, usually I have a slide with some of my projects, but this time I'll be talking about them, so no slide about them. So instead, I wanted to tell you something about the Gartner Hype Cycle. It lets you know how Gartner, which is a leading research and advisory company, sees the future of tech. And apparently it already exists since 1995. And yeah, it's really funny because object-oriented programming was once a disruptive technology. Anyway, you can find me on these topics. So like, I really try to cover my hype cycle. Basically, you can see that some of the technologies are crashing, and then you know you have to hop to the next thing. Yeah, I also have a GitHub account, so you can also follow me there. Okay, that was for the introduction part. Now, I want to talk to you today about what machine learning exactly is, for some of you that might not be exactly clear, and also then when we get to the when to use it. So I guess some of you have maybe cloned some Git code and run some examples, but that doesn't really give you a good feeling of what it actually is. So I hope to help with that. So what is it exactly? I want to do it without formulas, just with a couple of examples. So this is the first one, by using some data. It's not exactly big data, but yeah. So can anyone tell me what you would expect the answer to be for income here? Yes, it's very quick for people to see that it's most likely going to be 60,000. Would be a good estimation, right? So yeah, the whole idea is that you want a model to learn these kind of relations. So you have some input and you have some expected output. You want to predict income by the basis of age, and then a model can actually learn this. It's a linear model in this example. And basically, you want it to generalize to examples you have not seen before, which yeah, you can write a lot of if-else code, but yeah, basically a model can do that better than having to write a lot of if-else examples for this in this particular case. So another situation here is like, basically you would want to learn on, for example, the first three examples and then validate your model on the others. And then imagine you go into the wild and you see like someone age of 70, then the model can generalize to that unseen example. And for this, I actually wanted also to show you how to do this in some code, just to get a better grasp of what exactly it is. I have to switch my display, so that's going to be... Yeah, okay. So, it starts with having some data. And so we'll use the age example here again. Right, so this is your input, usually called X. That's at 60 there as well. And right, so now you have your input. Then you want to load a model. The simplest version here. And the idea is that you first fit it on data. So let's take the first, or the every second example in the first case, where we are going to train the model on. And then you can actually use it immediately for predicting the rest. So let's use the other half. This is kind of my lazy way of splitting data. Well, you can also now do, for example, let's ask what the model would say for 70. Okay, has to be. Oops. So there you see it. Now we have learned, we have trained a model on data, and it will generalize to other examples. And basically what you're doing is, this is a linear model. It learns the weight it should give for age to generalize to income. You can actually see this on the model as an example. Here it says, for every age that goes up by one, income should increase by 1,000. And every model that you have in machine learning is basically some parameters that it has. You're trying to learn it based on historical data, and then you hope that it will help you predict the thing you're interested in the future. So here's another example. So before we used a linear model, now this is a decision tree, which is also a very popular model, because it's easy to explain, right? It gives you some kind of tree with decisions of if else. It's easy to see what's going on. And the difference with the previous model is it could only capture a linear relationship between one or more variables. But with a decision tree, nonlinear things are possible, which you can see in this tree. And secondly, you can also not output only numbers, but also things like yes or no, or some name, apples or oranges. That's a benefit of a decision tree. So actually, simply put, that's pretty much all we can do with machine learning. You can predict some numbers, you can predict some classes, but it's nothing more than that. Another example would be with using text data is this. So you would have text as input, and you're predicting whether it's spam or not. So for example, hi John, how are you? We would probably say this is not spam, and then click link for free, that might be spam. Though of course, hi John, how are you could also be spam if your name is not John. So rather than writing a lot of if-else statements, you would prefer it if a model could do this for you. And so you would learn the logic based on the existing input and output. And it will assign different weights and different importances to your input. Okay, so today I want to go further on like the process of machine learning as well. So usually you have a problem where we go to a company, they have a problem, you have to pre-process their data somehow, then find a model that does this, and then you want to put it in a production system so that they can actually use it. This actually it sounds pretty difficult, just a four-step plan, but yeah, the particularly getting it in production, getting all the data, pre-processing, that just takes a lot of time. But yeah, if we look at the significance of machine learning in this whole thing, here it is. I thought let's use a Venn diagram for the illustration. And so, well, this is it, right? So you have like automation, then you have AI, and then you have machine learning, which is like the most important part. Well, actually, I think it's more something like this. So this is the correct slide. Machine learning is only a small part. It's a subset of the things you can do in AI things. And even that is a very small part, probably even smaller than on this slide, of actual automation. So yeah, in AI, you have usually complex algorithms like finding a shortest path. A nice example is Google Maps. For a big part, that's not going to be machine learning, but it can be other algorithms involved. But yeah, still there, the automation part is the most important. Like that takes the how do you get the data there to begin with? So. So now let's go over to some examples of when would you use it, and I'll be talking about some of my own projects here. So this is Bright ML, like convenient machine learned automatic brightness. It's I guess by now it's also already on your phones and you don't even notice it anymore, but on computers it's a bit different. And because in my particular case I have a MacBook, but I installed Arch Linux on it, I cannot recommend this. Don't try this at home. Working at night, I've noticed differences in white. So when I look at the browser, it might be very, very bright in your face. And when you look at your code, which is really dark, it doesn't really take this into account. So I thought it would be fun to do something with machine learning on this. And I wanted it to be zero configuration, right? So you don't have to move files or click buttons or whatever just to make it work. So let me show you. Let me show you that. Okay, I guess this is a bit difficult with two screens. Let me see. All right. So I made this thing for it. So basically, we will see what it's going to do. So whenever I change, I guess it's not really visible here, but that's because it's an external monitor. Basically, if we have like some different application there. So we switch between the applications. I guess it's a bit difficult. But you can see that it changes, right? It works better on without this kind of external monitor. I don't know how well it's visible, but yeah, basically you can see here features that are used for the model. So things that are important here are the light sensor. There's a light sensor in it, but I did not find this to be enough, particularly for the case of the Chrome browser, which was bright. And so you can see here that I take in features like, you know, which app is open, what could be my location, for example. Time is important, of course, your battery. And basically, the idea here is that you basically don't have to program anything. Whenever I change the brightness, it will actually learn from that. So it saves the output at the end of the changing. Okay, this is what you want under these circumstances. So also the example of how bright is your screen, like what is shown on the screen. This is something that they usually don't take into account. I've also added that, the mean pixel value of your screen. So basically the idea is as long as you have all the features there and I just keep changing my brightness, it will eventually just learn exactly what I want and I will never have to change it again. So sorry for the suffering with the with this. Yeah, it sends it to the room. Yeah. Everything is going to be open there. A bit difficult. Sorry. Was that working? It was working, right? we got this part covered. Yeah, so here's the actual like values in a code slide. So yeah, so the main point here is that you don't really notice the feedback loop here. So you know, the person that's going to use it doesn't have to know anything about that is actually happening. And that's really the great thing when you can do that with machine learning. So when you don't have a great cost of collecting new data, of making something personalized. So the other part is that indeed you can easily add new features. So the only thing that you have to do is make sure that the values are available in the model, and it will automatically incorporate this for the future. And basically, another important part here is that we want to create reusable models, and I'll get to this in the next part. Actually, creating reusable models creating reusable modules, or in this case, models, should be sounding familiar to developers at least. Which brings me to this point of where am I? Something else that I've created in BrightML. We are actually using the idea of where the computer is. So, in this case, we are learning so that the computer knows where it is based on the Wi-Fi signal. So, I guess I know now that I should just do the different way of. I think this is the setting I wanted, so we can just easily share the same screen. So I created this utility where we can learn out this location. We can call it like this. Now it will take a snapshot of the place where we are and actually learn it. I guess it's influenced by the fact that I'm in having a hotspot on. But basically, if we look at what it will use as input data in this case, this is pretty much it. So you can see all the like Wi-Fi things that are around and the quality of the signal. And basically, by knowing this, you can even, if we're going to stand on the other side of the room, it will still be able to tell the difference. And you can give your own label to it, as I show here. So we can make this point A, we can make that point B, and at least my computer will know where we are. You can see it here also, like the that's something I've integrated so that the computer knows or displays this value of where we currently are. So that's another example. Let's use this again. You get to see every slide a couple of times. Yeah, so basically, pluggability is very important here. We don't want to be having everyone to create their own models. You just want to have some base, and then people can adapt it to their own ways or use it as input for other things. I think this is where machine learning will be powerful. So pluggability is key, and it's easier to learn from an observation versus coding rules or using a config. So I've actually told you that we can only solve like these kind of input to output, right? Like we can predict a number or a class, and that sounds very limited, and it is actually really limited. But people have been very creative in how they can pose their problems as X to Y problems. So for example, in computer vision. And by the way, what would be any respectable presentation without a seemingly off-topic picture? So I think this is a fantastic example of a model that was trained. It was using a publicly available data set. And it learned to detect dogs. And then they looked at, OK, what does the model do wrong? And then they discovered these muffins in there. And so basically, here as input, you have the image, the raw pixels that is actually. So basically, you have all these pixels of an image, so 80 by 80. And then you have color channels. So it's like red, green, blue. And if you have that, you can completely display a picture. And you can also use those pixel values between 0 and 255 for color as input. So pretty much, that's like 18,000 or something examples. So there you have it. There's big data already. In the end, you could want to predict if it's a dog. Yes, that means one, or zero, no. So that's a creative. But in the end, you see that you're always predicting zero or one in the end. So I wanted to give here an example of the work that I've done at an insurance company. It's a very large and broad insurance company. And we were investigating car like if you can predict car damage. And they were trying to get data from their internal organization, which took very long to gather. And it even turned out that they only had it in PDF format, which was really, really crazy. But yeah, we would investigate what could do it for them. And ideally, we wanted to predict how much damage was on a image, like on a car image, based on the this example. So instead of using their own data, we started also working on an academic data set. We made the task a bit easier. So you would have more like this kind of car. And we wanted to see, for example, which of the side of the car are we looking at? Like, that's the first part. Then you want to detect even smaller parts of it. And you also have to detect things like brand. And well, actually, you start to realize it's a very complex thing. And even if you would know exactly what part of the car is damaged, even if you know how exactly big the scratch is, and then you know the car type and age of the car, I mean, that even if you have all those things, it's still very difficult to come up with a good estimate. But yes, it's very time consuming to do this. So yeah, it would be really good if they have it. Well, in the end, we use this, but yeah, the it's not really their core business in the end. But anyway, basically what we did in model wise is make use of something called transfer learning. So what Google has been doing was they've created a model on hardware that was like 30,000, or I think the whole thing costed 30,000 to create the model. And but they exposed it, so we were actually able to use this model of them, and you can see that it's a very deep model at those days, and only the red part, the last one, is the one that we have to retrain for our own examples. So basically, the model learned how to understand images on this dog muffin data set and a thousand other things, and the things that it learned from that to solve that challenge can be actually applied in this example to detect sides of cars and other details, like their useful features as well. So basically, you only have to retrain the last thing. So it doesn't take months anymore, but it can be done in a single day. And what's funny is that it was TensorFlow 0.8 in those days, and we made an Android app around it. So you can walk around and then hold it to a car, and then it will say which car side it is, or if there's a wheel in there. Yeah, we went pretty far in there. And yeah, it's possible by using transfer learning. But then you get back to the reality here is that, you know, there are even already strict rules in place of what is allowed and what not. And yeah, if we basically transfer learning can help, but if you cannot obey the rules that they already have, then that it's difficult to add that in a model. And basically, the complexity of such things, you would need an enormous amount of data to be even capture these kind of details. Furthermore, Furthermore, if you go to compliance and you say, you know, it the model works 60% of the time, then it always works, then, you know, they're not going to be very happy when people can be even fired for, you know, doing bad, you know, having a small UI mistake or whatever. You know, in a core business, you cannot have, you know, these kind of big mistakes. They are not really happy with that. So they'll experiment with it, but before you have it in production, that's like a whole different thing. So I wanted to give you now another example of a personal project of another like a complex problem. So basically what I wanted to do was to learn to write code with a generative model, which means like it takes the text that it has seen before and it will predict text after it. It can just generate new text. They do this for like even Shakespeare text generation, or is used in a lot of cases. And I thought, you know, it's going to be fun to actually have a neural network learn on neural network code to autocomplete neural network code. But yeah. Without too much details in there, basically you want to predict based on what you've seen the next word, or in this case I wanted actually to make it finish the whole sentence, because I thought that's an interesting idea in there. And what you can actually see is that the first time it here defines, I don't know how readable it is, but the first time it says model equals or model, it will suggest initializing it. When it notices that it's already defined, it will not suggest anymore to initialize it. But yeah, generating is rarely useful actually. It's more of a like art. It's really fun, or it can maybe help some processes, but it's like specifically having chatbots in mind, generation is not really a good idea. So now I want to talk to you about one of my more current projects, which is cryptocurrency. I don't know who here has cryptocurrency. I guess everyone is now a bit embarrassed to show their hands. It's a painful question at the moment. But yeah, so it's my only personal and closed source code. And it was 3 years ago when I started working on blockchain applications. And I was always really laughing when companies said that they're combining AI, blockchain, and IoT. And then I always thought, like, now they have three problems instead of one. But basically, I always used to think that it's too expensive or too difficult to do the trading. Too many people are already involved and already really complex models. But yeah, basically, I just thought, you know, let's collect data and let's analyze it myself and just see what are the big changes. Maybe it's possible to just respond to really obvious things instead of, you know, making time series models and doing very complicated models like that. It gets complicated and it's very difficult to debug in the reality, because, you know, a model can easily tell you that you're going to earn 700% in a month, but that's not usually going to be the reality, even though from a machine learning perspective you've done well. The reality is usually different. And so actually you don't need to You know what I've realized? I've realized that my notes are from the next slide, so it's very difficult. But my notes are switched. So anyway, don't underestimate the work necessary to like other than the machine learning. So making a model is only one part of the thing, and even if you do that part well, that doesn't mean it's going to work in out there. And I also realized that, you know, you can want to have something live, machine learning, trading, or you could actually do an analysis up front where you think about, okay, what are the actual big things, and then look for the very obvious patterns, and then just write something that is like really, really simple. So that could also be a way, right? You don't have to use the latest and greatest machine learning model in all cases. So simple is better than complex, like it's a Python mantra, right? And it also holds for models. So next one is I wanted to talk to you about is automated machine learning. I made it a package called X2I XToy. And what it basically does is does prepare the variables. It does something with missing values. It selects, or it actually doesn't do it, but it could select variables which you're going to use. You want to make it automatically choose a couple of models and validate which one is the best. You don't want to do this in a too, you don't want this to take forever, so you want it to be smart about what should it search for. But basically, I don't do image and time series in this. And yeah, it's just a very fun toy project to see something about automated machine learning. And basically, I want to use an example. I want to use Titanic as example, but not this one, but actually more like, you know, it's this kind of data. So it's the data from who survived Titanic. It's actually my favorite data set. And you can actually use this data to answer when they say women and children first, is that true? And I'll give you a spoiler, according to the data it is, so that's good news, I guess, for them, but not for people at the big data conference, I guess. But yeah, let's show you the module. So let's import the main object there. So I hope that this is makes sense. You have on the left, you have your code, right? And on the right, you can see how it's being evaluated. We want to first get again some data. Let's load the Titanic data. So just to give an idea of how this data looks like. So yeah, you have names, you have the gender, the age, how many siblings are there, like what type of ticket, in which, like were they first class or second class is also very interesting information, and on which station did they join the Titanic. So let's first grab the thing we're trying to predict. It looks like this. One means they survived, and zero means they didn't. And we want to use all other variables just to make it simple. So now we just threw that out, and we can say the input data is the rest. So now we define one of the x to y objects, and we fit it on, again, half of the data. And so now, even though there are missing values, categorical variables and everything, it just learned a model and it does it. And you can get even information about like what are the best features and stuff. Okay, the best features, whatever. So it will give you like a ranking. So it will help you create that first initial model. Oh. Yeah, so I don't know if you guys are familiar with the 80-20 rule, where you should, you know, spending only 20% of your time, you can get 80% of the profits. I think with machine learning, the issue is that we're always talking about models. We're talking about that for 80% of the time, even though maybe it's only 20% useful. So it's kind of the 20-80 rule, I guess. I would suggest in this case to actually make a domain-specific machine learning platform in your company, so that really helps you with your own data that's central in the company. And you can actually spend extra time on the important and reusable features, but other than that, just throw it in an automated pipeline. So you want to automate that whole process and actually spend time on creating or thinking about the actual problem rather than, you know, about this machine learning part. And yeah, don't underestimate the time to actually production. Okay, we're going over them again. Yep. So let's go to a conclusion. So machine learning in the end is just a tool, but it can be really powerful under the right circumstances. The question you should be asking yourself is, can you easily create a feedback loop? Is it easy to get labeled data, so where you know the answer? That is really crucial here. If it's very low, the cost, then you can then it really usually is a good example for where you want to use machine learning. Think about the like the pluggability of the, just try to solve a small problem with a small model and then reuse that in the next problem as input. Yeah, don't try to solve the most complex problems from the start. Make it into smaller problems. And also don't do it when there are too many strict rules already in place. So if you have an insurance company and they have a lot of strict rules that they already have in place, then you're going to have a difficult when a model says, yeah, but this is according to the data the better pattern. Then you're going to be like, yeah, well, this is how we're doing it. It's not going to work. So optimizing a model, it's really a lot of fun, but it's usually not the main gain. And never underestimate the work required besides the machine learning. And lastly, build a framework that can handle your typical data in the company, so that you don't have to spend all the time on making the model. This framework will allow you to do rapid iterations. So yeah, if someone says, okay, we also have this data, let's add it, then what you want to do is minimize the time to see what that effect is. You want to also be getting information about which variables are working, and this can lead you to actually, okay, we need to get the data right there, maybe, or this can be a useful place to look for it. So yeah. Yeah, my final and most important suggestion here is like make little projects and then give a presentation about your machine learning projects. That will really help you on feeling when you should be using machine learning or not.